Okay. We've reached 2 minutes after seven. We have an hour and a half before some buses have to leave, so we're going to get started. I'm Craig Thompson. I'm the president and CEO here of Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, and I'm the host this evening for this session. We call this, and this is the ninth year we've had this session, and so there have been 9 years of your predecessors here. We call it Modern Trends in Major Trends in Modern Cancer Research for Your Parents. Okay? We are here, and we have partnered with your schools to run this program to hopefully show you the excitement of science and medicine today and attacking things that we don't know about our bodies and ultimately solving problems of human disease. That's what we're all about here at Memorial Sloan Kettering. We will tell you a little bit about cancer, but that really isn't the focus of this evening. The focus of this evening is to understand that science and medicine can be incredibly rewarding careers, and there are many things your textbooks don't answer that need to be explored and understood. Because in fact, we study here, particularly in our research institute, and you're one of the two buildings of our research institute, one of the most complicated and poorly understood things that exists in the world today, and that's you. Okay? You are the most complicated thing anybody could ever imagine to study. And forget all the other things you've learned about biology. You came in as a complicated organism because each of the individual units that make you up are called cells, and that's what you learned in your biology courses. Anybody have any idea of how many cells you actually walked in with? And every one of you is going to have that same number of cells within about a 2% variation for the rest of your life, for the next 90 years. So what's the number, guys? This is participatory tonight. And all things that we do for the rest of the afternoon, so there's a hand is up. So what's the answer? 13 trillion. Big number. 10 billion, okay? So we're off by a couple factors of 10, okay?
3 trillion.
3 trillion, okay. 100 trillion, okay. So we got a pretty wide range. We start at the low of a billion and a high of 100 trillion. How many people for the 100 trillion? How many for the, I think it was 3 trillion? How many for the 1 billion? Not very many. Not that many people committed, right? It's an interesting problem. One of the debates that's been true for everybody, no matter what age they were, the U.S. is trying to get rid of the penny or not. Our colleagues to the north in Canada, they got rid of the penny because they just couldn't decide it was a meaningful currency. It isn't worth a lot. If every one of your cells had brought in a penny that it had found on the street with you tonight, well, first of all, you couldn't carry that amount, but you would be the richest individual in the world, and you'd be worth $600 billion. Because you have 60 trillion cells in your body. Now, for the people that answered and raised out, I used to give this lecture 10 years ago and say the number was 100 trillion. And then a couple of years ago, a student corrected me. They had gone on Google to see if I was right. And it turns out that Google says it's 60 trillion. So that's the right answer. That's an amazingly complex thing. You all come from schools that have between a couple hundred to a couple thousand students, and think how hard it is to get your class, which is one-fourth of that, to get organized to do anything. How do you get 60 trillion things to actually work together is just an amazingly difficult thing to imagine and even to begin to study. So we don't study all of it. We simply study here at the Research Institute how you maintain the right number of cells to maintain that constant number of cells throughout your adult life to feed and maintain all the organs that exist in your body and carry out all the functions your cells do to make you you. If you accumulate too many of those cells, That's really what the disease cancer is. The uncontrolled accumulation of cells in excess of what you need. We also study, because as scientists, if you understand one side of a problem, you should look at the other side. We also study when you lose the ability to maintain enough cells. Those are diseases of degeneration, and you're going to get a talk about one of those today, which is the disease diabetes. And these are two diseases, cancer and diabetes, that in fact every one of you has had a classmate who's experienced. Every one of you by this point knows someone in your school or neighboring school that's come down with cancer. And almost every one of you knows somebody that's gotten type 1 diabetes in which they've lost their ability to have the cells that make insulin that keep our blood sugar constant in their secretion. We study both aspects of that problem because we think by understanding why we lose the ability to replace cells and how we actually accumulate excess cells will teach us a lot about this disease, which is the most common life-threatening disease of Americans, and that is cancer. So we're going to talk about the science of this tonight, how we explore and discover cancer, how we think about how cells maintain themselves constantly in our body. The only time you ever make a new cell in your body is when you lose a cell. Normally, when you cut yourself, you need to make new cells to line your skin. When you get an infection with a virus or a bacteria, you make new immune cells that can make the antibodies and have the cellular functions to destroy that virus, seek it out throughout your body and control it. And so that process has taught us that every single one of us maintains a population of what we call progenitor cells or stem cells that are constantly able to replace the cells in our body that are lost as we go through life and cut ourselves and damage our skin or inhale something that gives us a cold or a cough and those kinds of issues. And so the process of how as adults we maintain what are called adult stem cells to constantly replace the damaged cells in our body and what can go awry so they die too quickly or they accumulate too much that causes cancer is the subject that we're going to study today. There are many other incredibly poorly explained aspects of human health, but we're going to focus on that just to show you the range of technologies that are capable of being studied today and the fields of exploration that come together in a disease-purposed hospital like this with a research institute. Tonight, you're going to be exposed to people trained as chemists, as engineers, as developmental biologists, and as physicians. We also have over 100 physicists, 60 mathematicians who have graduate degrees to actually carry out our work. So all aspects of science are informed by this. So if you want, you can ask about those in the sessions afterwards at the very time. We only have the opportunity tonight to show you three individuals that we are excited about their new approaches of bringing new technology and new approaches to science and tell you about their story of how they got interested in science and the problem they're trying to solve. The three individuals we're going to talk are shown up here. We're going to start right in at the deep end, but I have to give a couple ground rules first. We are filming this and it's being streamed out on the internet. And there is a variety of people that are watching both on the internet and actually in neighboring rooms because we weren't able to accommodate everybody that signed up here. So, when someone finishes, the first difficult thing is somebody has to be brave and actually has to go to one of the microphones to ask a question. We have to do it at the microphone so that the people in the other locations and on the internet can actually hear. But so that's going to be, so somebody think about who's going to be brave in the audience right then. Usually when one person does it, our past experiences, then we get a bunch of you. The most fun about this is when you ask the questions of what you didn't understand or what you took away from what each individual person said. And so you'll do that. If at any time you get excited about what you heard tonight, we have one additional advertisement we want to let you know. You've got some handouts. They're out at the table if you've got them last on your way in. But on your way out, if you're interested in this, every summer we have the opportunity to take students like you into our research programs And you can work with the individual investigators that you meet here or many others that you can see on the web if you become interested, if you actually want to learn what it's like to work in a working scientific laboratory on the problems that we're addressing tonight. So we hope and we count on that a number of you in this room are going to take us up on that possibility. We really look forward to that. It's one of the most exciting things we have going, which is the 60 to 100 students who come from high school to work in our research laboratories every summer. So this is not the end of a relationship, we hope, for many of you with this going forward. So with that, we're going to introduce the first individual. We're going to cover tonight these three disparate subjects. Dan Heller is going to tell us about how nanomaterials and expertise in chemistry and nanotechnology and engineering can be brought together to seek out cancer and study cancer as it grows in a living human being, a patient here in the hospital. We actually do practice what we do research on here with the patient's consent, always informed, but we are at any one time taking care of, unfortunately, 125,000 patients with cancer at this institution. And there will never be a day that the 13,000 people that come to work here aren't interested in putting ourselves out of business by discovering cures and treatments for cancer. And Dan's focused on helping us find cancer earlier and actually image it in a way. And he's brought his expertise from his training at MIT and his training as a chemist to bring to bear on finding cancer and studying it as it exists in a human being, a living human being in real time. So Dan, you're on.
There we are. So I have a couple important questions to ask you. The first, who likes building things? I guess a good number. I like building things, and I like when I was a little younger, I was building a lot. I was building using my creativity to make all sorts of interesting creations. I was building things that had function, like that rocket there that's shooting up. I was building things, and I also liked learning how the world works, which is very important. And so I got interested in physics and engineering. But I took a winding path, as I mentioned. I took a winding path, and that was one of the best things I did. I ended up not studying physics in college. I ended up studying history. And I learned a lot. And one of the things that I learned that I was really happy about was that I learned how to communicate what I do to people, mostly through writing, talking sometimes. And that was very crucial. And while I was studying history, I was learning some science, but I actually didn't get a degree in science in college. I then went to become a teacher. Who's a teacher here? I think we need a round of applause for the teachers. Thank you for what you do and who you put up with every day. So I became a middle school teacher right after college. And I actually was teaching, got into teaching middle school science. And what I learned from that is that science is relatively awesome. And I should go back into it. And that's what I did. And so I started taking classes at night school while I was a teacher in organic chemistry and applied to PhD programs and ended up going to a PhD program in physical chemistry. And so that's a winding path. But I'm so glad I did that because I learned how to communicate and I learned that science is relatively awesome. And I learned how to, and eventually I when I was studying physical chemistry, I got kind of back to my roots and started building things. And I was building microscopes and building systems in order to understand biology, in order to understand chemistry. And it turns out that there's a lot of need to build things in a place like this. And there are many people here, as Dr. Thompson mentioned, who are scientists in the sense that they're biologists that are trying to answer questions. They're trying to answer questions about how our bodies work, how and diseases affect them. And there are many people here who are doctors, maybe those doctors right there, who work here, who understand what patients are going through, understand diseases, understand the clinical aspects of a disease. And there are people that can make technologies for both to help doctors and to help scientists. To help scientists, one needs tools to do their work. Everything a scientist does is physically, or usually physically, using a tool in order to probe biology. And so if we can make tools for scientists, we can accelerate the pace of research. If we can make tools for doctors, we can make therapies that work better. And so I kind of sum all these people that make tools into engineers, people who make things. And that's pretty much who I am. But in order to make things that really work well for the scientists and work well for the doctors, we need to collaborate. And so, and that goes back to that communication aspect, what I do is talk to doctors, talk to biologists, and understand how I can help them. And sometimes I can't walk up to them and say, how can I help you? What can I make? Sometimes I just have to, it takes a long time and a lot of conversation to be able to understand what exactly I can do. Because if I'm making technologies and there's problems that need to be solved, it's hard to know exactly what technologies to make. And certainly there's only readily available, there's only a little bit that of overlap where I can make technologies and there are problems, and in the middle where they come together are those solutions. And so I'm trying to make more and more technologies to make more and more solutions to problems, but what I'm really trying to do is make technology to talk to people with the problems and to understand how I can help. And so in order to do that, I'm making basically two sets of tools to help to answer many questions and to solve problems. I'm making materials that can try to target diseases, especially to metastatic cancer, because that's basically a big problem in cancer is when the disease spreads. And so I'm making tiny little particles to target that cancer. And the other half of what my lab does is we make technologies for early detection and also for research tools. And for that, I'm actually working with carbon nanotubes. And so you're going to hear a tiny little story about each one. First, the nanoparticles. Basically, I needed to learn a lot about cancer in order to make these tools. And so I talked to a lot of biologists and said, what are the biggest problems? And one is, you know, these are the common metastatic sites in breast cancer. And targeting metastatic cancer would be excellent. If we can take cancer medicines, cancer drugs, and get them to go to these sites and only act on those sites of the cancer instead of going everywhere, that would make people healthier. That would be more effective therapy. And those therapies would also make people feel less sick, like chemotherapeutic drugs can do. So what I had to understand is how cancer, how a small tumor becomes a big tumor. Because what happens is, in a small tumor, it needs nutrients, it needs food, it needs access to the blood supply. And so what happens in small tumors, and often these are tumors that are metastatic tumors, they might be away from the primary site of the cancer, they actually secrete factors that cause blood vessels to go up and get near them and grow near them. And so what happens is in order for a tumor to grow big, it needs to basically have these, the process is called angiogenesis, have these blood vessels grow and feed that tumor. And that's how a small tumor ends up growing. But the interesting thing is that in these blood vessels are called neovasculature. They're new, and they aren't made the same exact way as normal blood vessels. They have other molecules in them that in the walls of these blood vessels that we can use to target. And so in a wall of a neovasculature, of this new blood vessel, there are molecules that are much smaller than this and probably don't look like that. But they have a certain shape, and that shape is key, because there are other molecules that can actually fit those shapes. And so we can try to use these molecules on the neovasculature, on the walls, to try to get a drug only to the site of this vasculature, of this blood vessel that is newly made and is in the vicinity of the cancer, is feeding the cancer. And so what we're doing is we're making nanoparticles, which is represented by this bunch of rubber bands, which actually is made out of, we're making them out of polymers, so that's actually not that far away from the truth that this looks like a bunch of rubber bands. And what we're doing is we're decorating that particle with the molecule that can use to target the molecules that are in the blood vessels. And then we fill that molecule with a cancer drug. And we're working, we talk a lot to the people who understand these targeting and to understand the actual drug that we put in, so that we have a tumor-targeted kind of nanobomb. And the idea is, and this is what they actually look like in our lab. This is a person in my lab, and she took a scanning electron micrograph, and they're about 100 nanometers in diameter, which is about 1,000 times smaller than the width of a human hair. And what we do is if these are injected into the blood, what we're trying to do is make these particles go and stick, like this little key in the keyhole, stick to those molecules and target. And then what will happen over time is they will degrade, or a cell will eat them, and then they'll release the drug to that vicinity. And so what we're trying to understand, because we really, even though we make something, we definitely want to try it out, we're trying to still understand things about this. What we're trying to understand is when these nanoparticles go and stick to the blood vessels that are around a tumor, we found that in many cases they can actually get rid of this tumor, and we're trying to figure out exactly how. Do they degrade and destroy the blood vessel that's feeding the tumor, or can they actually get the drug directly to the tumor? And that's important because we want to know what kind of drug to actually use. Do we want one that will just destroy blood vessels, or do we want one that will actually target something in that tumor? And so even as we make these technologies, we're trying to understand more just about how they work. And the hope is that we will have new nanotherapies that we can use to target metastatic disease and then get rid of that tumor. There's one other type of technology I want to talk to you about. And really, the problem is what you need to focus on first. We need better sensors. We need better ways to detect molecules, especially in living cells and in living people. And so we want to know, we have questions like, inside of a living cell, what's going on? What kind of molecules are being made at which times? And in a cancer cell, how are those molecules different? And basically, there's tons and tons of problems. One of the type of molecules I'm trying to look at are oxidants, the things that people talk about that are countered by antioxidants. Can oxidative radicals and oxidants, how do they change in concentration inside of a cancer cell? And so we right now there's very few ways inside of a living cell to see what's going on in terms of those oxidants. And we also want to know, of course, where the cancer is, where those molecules that are produced by the cancer go, and so can we make technologies to see where those are. And so what I'm making are fluorescent sensors made of carbon nanotubes. And you'll see in a minute why they could be useful for this kind of application. It's not just a toy. It could actually be used as a legitimate sensor inside of living cells and people. And what they are fluorescent sensors. So light hits these nanotubes, and the nanotubes glow. I don't know if you've seen fluorescence. You've probably seen fluorescence before. You usually might have like one of these UV lights that would probably make your clothes glow if they weren't made of dark materials, but this is a piece of uranium in a glass with uranium ions in it. And so this is a UV light, and you can see that this, when we hit this uranium glass with the UV light, it glows. It's fluorescent. And one thing about it is that the light that's hitting it is higher energy, or bluer, or more towards the UV, than the light that it gives off. And so we're doing this we're playing with materials that fluoresce in my lab, and a carbon nanotube is fluorescent, or certain ones are fluorescent. Carbon nanotube is just made of total carbon. This is one sheet of graphite called graphene, and if it were rolled up into a tube, it becomes a carbon nanotube, and this is about 100,000 times thinner than the diameter of a human hair. And this carbon nanotube can be made in many different shapes, but all the sizes are very, very, very thin, but they have slightly different structures. And those structures are very important because of what's called the quantum size effect. So this is our microscope in our lab, and what I'm doing is shooting laser at not carbon nanotubes, which is a fluorescent dye, showing a microscope that shoots a laser up through a dye. And we can use this microscope to shoot a laser at our nanotubes and make them glow. And so what happens is that carbon nanotubes exhibit this effect. It's one of the effects that physicists are really interested in terms of looking at nanoparticles. The quantum size effect is basically where electronic properties, and also they're related to the optical, the visible properties of certain materials, are very different when they get down to the nano size. And so if you have some semiconducting material, and I'm going to talk about one called cadmium selenide briefly. If you have this material, it looks like a kind of silicon-like material if it's big. But if it's small, it has really interesting properties. Because if you have a piece of cadmium selenide and you have a nanoparticle made with it, it could actually glow when you shoot light at it, just like I showed you. And depending on the size, the diameter of this nanoparticle, you can actually change the color of the fluorescence of this of these quantum dots. And so they're tiny little crystals that are super tiny. This is an electron microscope micrograph, 5 nanometers, is very, very small. But it still gives off red light. If you make it smaller, it gives off blue light or green light. And so we can make materials, with nanotechnology, we can make materials that have interesting properties that completely depend on their size, but only have these interesting properties when they're really, really small. And so carbon nanotubes actually have an interesting, similar property, except instead of glowing in the visible range, they glow in the infrared. So they are fluorescent, but in the range that you can't even see. And so these are different carbon nanotubes that are very, very slightly different in diameter, have slightly different structure. And this is a spectrum of the fluorescence. This blue graph is a fluorescence of the spectrum of different carbon nanotubes. And they actually glow in a range where light could actually penetrate through the skin. So you can actually maybe even implant these things under the skin and shoot a laser, and it would be a laser just like this, and then the light would come off, and you would have to have a special detector to detect it, and you can actually see them glow. And so what we're trying to do, and these are some carbon nanotubes in a microscope, where the fluorescent microscope that I just showed you, where we have light shooting at these, and we're looking at a really, really small scale. All of these are very, very tiny. The width is still less, 100,000 times smaller than a human hair, and the length kind of varies here. And so these are carbon nanotubes glowing in the infrared, and you couldn't see them in a microscope if you look through the eyepiece, because you could only see them if you have a special detector that can see this infrared light between about 900 and 1400 nanometers. And so what we're doing with these is we want to make sensors out of them, because these things can actually change intensity or change wavelength, can change color depending on their environment. And so what we're doing is we're wrapping these in polymers and materials to harness these two properties of this changing intensity and wavelength to make these specific to detect molecules that we want to detect, like these oxidant molecules. And so we can actually, the nice thing about these is they're so small that many of them can go into a single cell. And these are movies of carbon nanotubes moving around in individual cells. And we're able to make rapid movies, so we can actually detect things and quantify them in real time and actually measure what's going on inside a cell in real time. Here, I'm just showing you the nanotubes. But what we're going to do is we're using the intensity and the color, the wavelength of these, measuring them over time and seeing changes and using that information to quantify different things in the cells. The way we do that is we wrap carbon nanotubes in these materials, make them specific for, say, a cancer biomarker or these oxidants, and then when they bind, we can see specific changes and use those changes to get the number to quantify how much of these molecules we can see. And so we can put them in the cells and try to detect things like oxidants and small molecules. We also are thinking, well, maybe we can do something like this. we can take some nanotubes and implant a tiny, tiny, tiny little bit under the skin. It would almost be like a tattoo, but it's invisible. And then have maybe a watch that can shoot a laser from the watch, and or maybe a phone or something like that. And then the light, and then have a detector that where after shooting the nanotubes, they're fluorescing, they're glowing, but they're glowing in the infrared, so the light's getting through the skin and to the detector. And so maybe we can make watches that can actually detect whatever you want. Maybe you can think of something you really want to detect that's in the blood, and we can measure that in real time and see changes, and maybe tell us if there's a disease, or tell us whatever we want to know. And so with that, I should tell you who's doing this work, because I'm just one person, and there are many people in my lab. Well, there are about 10 people in my lab that are a mixture of, we have one biophysicist, we have a couple chemists, we have a chemical engineer, we have pharmacologists, and Januka is a polymer chemist that makes these interesting helical polymers. And then we're talking, but we're not just working alone, we're actually talking, as I mentioned before, to doctors and to biologists to understand how to make these technologies. And so this is where our lab is. And basically, we're making these nanomaterials, nanoparticles. We're understanding how they give off light. We're collaborating with doctors and making biosensors and therapies. And so with that, I'll be happy to take any questions.
This is where somebody has to be brave. You have to come up to the microphone so they can hear you on the internet as well as in the back rooms. So come on up to the mic. Yes. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Emmanuel. I'm in the eighth grade. And my question is, does the size of the nanotube affect how it treats the tumor?
Thanks for the first question, Emmanuel. I love teaching the eighth grade. And so the size of the size of a nanoparticle, say that again, does it affect how it gets into the tumor?
Yes.
So yes. And so if we make a nanoparticle, of course, too big, that will not be able to get into the small blood vessels, the capillaries, and not be able to get to the tumor. But if we make it too small, we've actually seen problems as well. So there is a specific size range, and actually that's an area, which you asked, is an area of active research. People are trying to understand how the size of a nanoparticle can affect exactly where it's going to go. And so actually there's a lot of questions and a lot of work that need to be done. Next.
Hi, I was wondering how your team decides to pick which problems to tackle, and I mean, there's so many.
Well, that's an excellent question. I think about those two big spheres, and you think about those two spheres, the problems, the technology, and then there's some overlap. And we try to find the things, we want to find the biggest problems with the biggest needs, and then we also want to try to figure out, where our technologies can come close enough and to really address the problem, because we don't want to make something that, just lights up and just, seems to be interesting. We want something that will really solve the problem. And so it really takes a lot of understanding about our technology and understanding and a lot of discussion, as I mentioned, with the doctors and with the biologists to understand the problem, to think, oh, maybe we actually have something. And it's really coming up with ideas, understanding enough about the science to be able to come up with a great idea where you can make the biggest overlap and the biggest solution.
Hi, my name is Latoya. I'm in the eighth grade, and my question is, how does cancer develop in a human's body?
Wow. That's a very good question. And actually, I'm going to have to pass, not because I don't know anything about cancer, because I do, but I think that there are two people who are going to talk a lot more about cancer.
In our third talk, we're going to talk about that and how we learn about the different individual ways that cancer can come up. So I think we'll hold that question till later.
Thank you.
It is absolutely an appropriate question for all of our speakers, but our best answers will come at the end of the session. So thanks.
When you use the nanotubes to detect cancer cells, will it affect other cells or body systems?
So if our idea, that's a good question, and that has to do with, we think about how invasive something is. If something is invasive, it could cause damage in the body. We try to make whatever technology we're making to be minimally invasive, meaning if we implant a sensor into the body, we want it to be small, we want it to be able to not affect anything around it, and so, but that's still something that we have to understand, we have to study that exact question. And so that's something we're gonna have to find out by ourselves.
I asked Dan that exact question when he came to the institution, and the amazing thing is they found a size range of these things that in fact it can go and interrogate the chemistry at the site of a cancer cell, and when it's done, it actually gets peed out in our urine. And so it's a pretty amazing phenomenon that these things are so small that they can pass right through our body safely and yet perform these amazing chemistry tests. So we're going to switch to this side now. For the brave ones on this side, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Esther. I just wanted to ask quickly, what inside these technologies ensure that they don't attack innocent, healthy blood vessels?
That's a very good question again, and something that that people have also asked me before. And it turns out that if we find the right target, and make the right particle with the right targeting molecule on it, where there's only one key that fits the keyhole, then we'll be able to get it to be specific. But if we have and specifically just get our nanoparticles to the cancer, and if we have choose the wrong target and the wrong key in the wrong keyhole, then there'll be problems. But the nice thing is that if you can increase, right now there are many molecules that if they're the older style cancer drugs that can go everywhere, even if we can increase the specificity a little bit or a moderate amount, that could mean that it could be much more effective.
Okay, thank you.
Over here.
Hi, my name is Imani. I'm in eighth grade, and my question is, how do cigarettes form a tumor when it's not made of the nutrients it wants?
How do cigarettes form a tumor?
Form a tumor. Wow, that's another cancer biology question that I should probably defer, if that's okay. I'm sorry.
We'll do that later. Come back up after the third talk and ask that question. It'll be a great question for our third speaker. Next.
Okay. Hi. Could I just?
Yeah.
Okay. Hi. I'm Sonam, and I'm from International High School. I have two questions. How accurate are the nanotube sensors in detecting cancers?
So that's a very good question. And right now, we have sensors that can detect certain molecules that are produced in certain cancers. And so we have sensors that we've been testing with blood and with cells. And so far, they're very, very specific. Mm-hmm. And the question is, though, when we get to patients, and right now we're actually doing those studies where we take patients' blood and give it to our sensor, and that's actually what we're going to test in about a couple weeks. So you got good timing there.
Okay, second question. What type of cancer is more easily detectable with your nanotube sensors?
That's another good question. It turns out that if we have a molecule that we can put on our nanotube sensors that can bind to the target, the cancer biomarker, as we call it, then it ends up being, it's basically unlimited. And so right now, there are many types of, many cancer biomarkers, and so we actually can do this with many, many, many types of cancer, but the question is when we test them on patients, how effective they are they, and that's what we have to test. Mm-hmm.
Okay,
you
guys have risen to the challenge. And so I'm only going to be able to have time for two more questions. The rest of you will have to rush back up at the end. No, they're going to be the people who came in line, so one on each side. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Brittany. I'm in the eighth grade, and my question is, when creating a drug for cancer, how is it tested to make sure it's attacking the tumor and not making it worse?
So in very few cases that I know of that we give a cancer molecule and it really gets the cancer worse, but there are types of drugs that they can stop working. And so in this case, what we use are in to figure out if a cancer is getting worse or not, there are we have many people here who are radiologists, radiochemists, people who look at who use radiation to probe, like MRI or PET scans, and you can actually use that to image a person and see where their cancer is. And so right now there are very, very cool technologies that can actually tell you a lot of the answers to these questions.
Last question.
Hi, my name is Tom, and I'm from International High School for Health Science. So I have a question is about when the nanoparticle kill the tumor, will it also damage the normal cell?
Right. So right now there are many types of molecules, the very old style chemotherapeutic drugs that exact thing is a problem, and that's why some cancer patients can lose their hair and have and feel really bad because they're damaging normal cells. And so the idea is with the nanotechnologies is that we're encapsulating that cancer drug inside of this particle that keeps it away from the normal cells, and then only brings that and only brings that drug to the site of that marker that's in the disease. And so that's exactly why we're putting these inside of nanoparticles.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to move on to our next speaker. We thank Dan for a stimulating talk.
I should remind the students, for those that are interested in physics in particular here, Dan is exploiting the properties of light and particles that are passing through our body all the time to make them new ways to detect cancer in living organisms such as ourselves. And the infrared light he talked about, the positron emission tomography, which are positrons, a particle that's created by annihilation, are actually for the first time being exploited in medicine to help people in real time. And while you're in college, you're going to see many of those things reach, but through him and his colleagues, fruition. The other amazing technology we want to introduce to you today is the idea that every single one of the cells in our body can be reprogrammed back to the first cell that started us out in life, back to a stem cell. And that was discovered by scientists in Asia about 10 years ago. That led to a Nobel Prize a couple of years ago. And it made to the amazing discovery that we could reprogram our tissues, cells from our tissues, back through the stem cell stage, and then differentiate them to become any other cell type in the body. And for the first time, we could exploit that for what we now call regenerative medicine. And understanding the processes by which the cell de-differentiates and differentiate, we can learn much about the pathogenesis of cancer and diseases of cell loss. And we're very privileged to have our next speaker, Danwei Hung Fu, who joined us from Harvard University, where she was one of the leading scientists. Discovering how we produce those cells that make insulin that protect us from diabetes in her lifetime. And she takes what she learned to do some amazing science she's going to tell you about. Anyway.
Thank you. So what I'm going to tell you about today is how my lab is using human pluripotent stem cells to model the process of disease progression and understand disease mechanisms. And as you may imagine, this kind of basic understanding is critical for development of treatment, such as treatment for cancer. So in my talk, I'll first tell you about why do we actually need a new model to understand human diseases. And then I will tell you what are human pluripotent stem cells and how we are using human pluripotent stem cells to understand diseases such as diabetes and pancreatic cancer. So for most of my talk, I'll focus mainly on diabetes, but towards the end, I'll touch upon the pancreatic cancer also a little bit. As you sort of are aware of, everyone here, we are all different. We are different in overt features such as hair color, size, and weight. We are also different in that we have different disease susceptibilities. And some people, they have a, I think my slide is slightly messed up, but some people, they're born with congenital birth defects, such as they're missing an important organ, such as the pancreas. And a big part of what makes us different, but not all, is the sequences in our DNA, in the genome. And as you could imagine, one way to figure out how a disease arises would be to sequence the genome and find out what kind of DNA mutations or variations are associated with different types of diseases. Now, you probably know that in recent years, the sequencing technology has made a lot of progress, and we can right now we are approaching the goal of potentially to do sequencing the human genome in with $1,000, or I guess it's not there quite there yet, but it's close. So with that kind of progress, what we are seeing is we are now able to identify human disease-associated genes with an ever-accelerating rate. And these are mutations in genes that are identified through whole genome sequencing or sequencing particular parts of the genome. And there are similar methods, such as the genome-wide association studies, that also allow us to identify mutations in the human genome that are associated with diseases. Now, the question is, we all know that association is not equal to causality. So how do we validate the functional significance of disease-associated genes? So I'm just going to give you one example. So this is a gene that has been identified through sequencing efforts to be linked to neonatal diabetes. So these are patients who are born actually without a pancreas. So because in the pancreas, as Craig actually mentioned, there is an important cell type called beta cells. These cells are critical in terms of regulating our blood glucose levels. And in the absence of the pancreas and the beta cells, these patients, they cannot regulate the blood glucose levels, and hence they get diabetes. Now, in this case, these patients, they have basically one allele of this GATA6 gene mutated, and they get the disease. And actually, human genetics has been wonderful in that there are lots of mutations identified in different patients that have been telling us a lot about what this gene actually can do. So in color here are basically important domains of this GATA6 protein. And in black are mutations that are predicted to make the protein truncated, so that therefore the protein would actually be predicted to be not functional. And in red are mutations that basically change specific amino acid sequences. So these are basically one amino acid substitution. And as you might imagine, if the mutation actually happens in somewhere else in the protein, they're usually tolerated. But in this case, they happen in a very particular domain of the protein that's quite important for the protein function. And that's why they actually give a disease phenotype. So the question is, now that we actually have a lot of the sequencing information, how do we actually get to understand the disease at a functional level? And many of us here actually uses mouse as a wonderful model system to understand human diseases. However, in the end of the day, mouse is not human, and in this particular case, it's very striking in that if you have delete one allele of GATA6 in mice, these mice are completely normal. They have pancreas, and they actually are not even diabetic. Now, even when you delete both copies of GATA6, the mice are still normal. If you even examine the pancreas at microscopic level, there are no defects that could be found. So the disease that sort of mimics the human condition only appears when you delete both GATA4 and GATA6. As you can sort of imagine from the name, GATA4 is a sister gene that's similar to GATA6. So in this case, the disease is very different in the condition of human. Deleting one copy of GATA6 gives you a disease that's very severe, while in mouse, it requires the deletion of four copies. And basically, it tells us that using mouse models, it's not adequate to actually recapitulate the human disease phenotype. So what do we do? We and others are using human pluripotent stem cells to model human disease phenotypes. So these cells, they have the wonderful ability to differentiate into all cells in our body. So therefore, they give us a unique opportunity to gain insights into human development and disease that are not readily available from model organisms. These cells can also self-renew, meaning they can be propagated in the laboratory basically forever. Therefore, it actually allows us to examine many genes like GATA6 with this kind of high throughput that was not readily available using mouse studies as well. Now, how do we get to these cells? So there are two ways to make human pluripotent stem cells. One way is through reprogramming from for example, a skin fibroblast cells, or just simply draw blood from a patient. And then to overexpress a number of transcription factors in these cells to make what's known as the induced pluripotent stem cells. So some of you know, and as Craig has mentioned, in 2012, Shinya Yamanaka is the person who pioneered this approach, and he received the Nobel Prize for that. Now, the other way to generate these pluripotent stem cells is also through reprogramming, but using a slightly different technology known as somatic cell nuclear transfer. And it generates embryonic stem cells. And this is also, so together with Shinya Yamanaka in 2012, another scientist, John Gurdon, received the award because of he pioneered the somatic cell nuclear transfer technology first in Xenopus, perhaps more than 50 years ago. So as you could imagine, these type of technology is incredibly powerful. For example, you could imagine if a patient is missing a pancreas, theoretically, one may be able to first make the stem cells and then coax the stem cells to form a pancreas. And then these pancreas can theoretically be transplanted back into the patient without worries for immune rejection. Of course, we're not there yet. There's a lot more work to be done. But that's what gets people extremely excited about this type of technology. Now, what I want to talk about today is how do we use this technology to do disease modeling. So the concept is actually relatively simple. You can imagine if you have a patient with a disease, say lack of a pancreas, in theory, what one can do is to make iPS cells or pluripotent stem cells so that we could capture the disease mutation in these iPS cells. And if we're talking about a monogenic disease, that is a disease caused by mutations in a single locus, this sounds pretty straightforward because we can then try to differentiate the cells and maybe in the vitro environment or after transplantation, see the lack of pancreas phenotype. Now, in reality, this is a bit more complicated. As if we were to directly compare the blue individual here with the pink individual, in addition to the suspected disease-associated mutations, there are many, many, many differences between these two individuals, just like no two people in here would have the same genetic information. So even if we were to see a phenotype, it is difficult to attribute to these two particular mutations that are present between these two individuals just because these two people are so different. So ideally, what we need to do is to find an individual who everything else is the same, but the only difference is the mutation in the disease-associated locus. Now, we know that's next to impossible because even between sisters or siblings, there are lots of differences between the two individuals. But what we can do is to basically edit the genome so that we artificially create the iPS cells that will resemble a person that's actually not, that doesn't even exist, so that basically these cells, the only difference between these two cells would be that particular mutation that we are interested in. Now, this sounds relatively simple, huh? It's because all we want to do is to introduce a specific mutation into the genome. But in reality, this is actually incredibly difficult to do. So in human ES cells, but also in mouse cells and other types of cells, this kind of precise genome editing has been extremely difficult. But there has been a technological breakthrough in very recent years that allow us to do just that. Now, so what we actually have now in our hands are what's called as the DNA scissors. So there are different types that are, so some of you might have heard about, talons, CRISPRs, and zinc finger nucleases. But it doesn't matter what they are called. Essentially what they do is they introduce a specific DNA double-strand break in the DNA, in the genome. Now, you might be wondering, that's incredibly dangerous, isn't it? Why would we want to cut our DNA? And the truth is, we actually all live dangerously, so our cells are undergoing a lot of DNA damage on a daily basis. But the good news is, the cells have actually come up ways to actually fix the DNA damage. And what we do by artificially introduce these DNA damages is to take advantage of the systems that the cells already have to introduce mutations into the genome. So the cells can fix the DNA damage through an error-prone mechanism. So it is sort of like if you get a quiz, there is a question you don't know. You would just fill in something in the hope that you may get it right. So sometimes when the cell doesn't know what to do, it basically fixes the DNA double-strand break through an error-prone mechanism, which will introduce mutations into the genome. So the mutations will be a little random, but you could imagine if the mutations are in the gene of interest or in an important functional domain of a gene of interest, it's likely to introduce a knockout or a gene disruption. Now, the cell also has a mechanism to fix the DNA double-strand break in a way that's precise. And using this way, what we do is to provide the cell with a template. And the template will contain the exact mutation we want the cells to take. So therefore, we will be able to actually modify the genome in a way that's extremely precise, allowing us to make disease-mimicking human pluripotent stem cells. And lastly, it's very similar to the middle approach, is that we could also insert bigger, larger pieces of DNA sequences into the genome in very much the same way. Now we have cells that are modified, cells that are not modified. So the idea is we want to take the cells down the differentiation pathway in order to mimic what actually happens in a human being. So the idea would be that we know our cells differentiate in a stepwise manner. So the cells initially are naive, so they can become many different things, just like the pluripotent stem cells that we talk about. But during the process of development, they would first, for example, become cells that will later give rise to the endoderm cells, for example, the lung cells, the liver cells, or intestinal cells or pancreatic cells. Now, the next step, these endodermal cells, they would decide to become even more specialized to become pancreatic progenitor cells. Now, these progenitor cells, they no longer have the ability to form lung cells, but they are specialized in that they can form all lineages in the pancreas. And then these pancreatic progenitor cells can be further coaxed to become cells like beta cells. And this is a very simple slide, but it's actually a lot of work done by the field that now allows us actually to make functional beta cells, in fact, just very recently. Now, the idea of using this kind of experiment is one can actually use this kind of modification and to tell whether the modification actually caused the disease phenotype. But not only that, when a patient comes to the doctor's office, what we see is, hey, the patient doesn't have a pancreas. But it is difficult to tell when during development does everything go wrong. However, Using the in vitro system that we have, it is possible now to look at each individual step during the cellular differentiation process and understand the disease mechanism and also to interrogate it further using additional cellular or biochemical approaches. So I'll just show you one data slide. This is actually what we see in the dish. So in blue, these are the pancreatic progenitor cells that I'm talking about. So these are the cells that will give rise to the entire pancreas. And in green and red, so these are, in red are the beta cells, and in green are alpha cells. So these are cells that are also present in the pancreas, but serves as a different function. Now, this is the wild type situation where we are seeing both beta and alpha cells. And in this particular mutant, the cellular differentiation didn't happen, so there's no endocrine alpha or beta cells. And in this mutant, there is an excess of alpha and beta cells. And in the last one, only one cell type is affected, but not the other. So using this kind of technology, it's becoming incredibly powerful, and it allows to look into many genes, actually, in ways that are much faster than what traditionally can be done using mouse genetics. So what I want to tell you is that so far, what I've been telling you about is neonatal diabetes. It's actually pretty rare. But diabetes is a spectrum disorder in that what you see in the relatively milder form of the type 2 diabetes is the neonatal diabetes is the more extreme form. And what we know is that neonatal diabetes, it's a monogenic disease. So basically, it's caused by deficiencies in one gene. So it's relatively easy to study. Now, the type 2 diabetes is more complex. So it's caused by mutations or polymorphisms in many different genes. And it also has an environmental component. So what we hope to achieve is by studying this more extreme disease condition, we may be able to gain insights into the more complex disease and also set the stage for directly studying these more complex disease using human pluripotent stem cells. Now, using the last two slides, I'm going to talk a little bit about pancreatic cancer, which is a disease that my lab is also interested in. And one reason for studying pancreatic cancer is really it's a very, very lethal disease. Even though it actually affects a relatively small portion of people, but because it's very difficult to detect early on and there's a lack of effective treatment, many patients would die, and it's one of the leading causes of cancer-related death. So if you think about modeling pancreatic cancer, it's actually more complex. Because if you think about having a patient here with a mutation, with pancreatic cancer, if you were, I think many of you probably know that cancer is a somatic mutation. Most of the cancers are caused by somatic mutations. So that means if you take the patient and draw the blood and make iPS cells, these cells will be essentially normal. Now, you could actually make iPS cells from the cancer cells as well. But these cells are not quite right either, because these are cells that have undergone a lot of mutagenesis and loss of chromosome events. And they don't really recapitulate early events during cancer progression. And in cancer therapy, what we really need is to understand what happens early on, because that gives us a window of opportunity for treatment of the disease. Now, what we would like to do in the lab is instead of making iPS cells directly, is to take the healthy cells, make pancreatic tissue, and then introduce cancer-related mutations in a sequential manner. So what that will allow us to do is, for the first time, we may be able to model tumor progression in a way that's relatively well controlled. But it'll also allow us to distinguish, for example, drivers versus passengers, that mutations in cancer development. With that, I would also like to introduce you to my group. So these are the people that are behind all the work, and we are very excited to come to the lab every day, because there may be something new that's waiting for us to discover. Thank you.
Question for Dan Wei. Yes.
I just wanted to know, does the body ever reject the donor DNA?
Donor DNA. So what we are talking about here is as a cell replacement therapy, the idea is you will be making the cells and transplant the cells into the body. And yes, rejection is a potential worry. So the idea of using iPS cells is you will be using the patient's own cells to generate cells that will be used for transplantation. So theoretically, that overcome a lot of immune rejection issues. However, how that works in an actual human is something that remains to be found out.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Hi. You know, when you talked about how you you target the flaws in the DNA and you fix it, right? Can we do that to bacteria and viruses so they target cancer cells and they do the work for us?
That's a great idea. I think first of all, the first part of the question, can we use the similar type of technology to target bacteria and viruses? And I believe actually for targeting bacteria, there's a paper just came out that yes, it's possible to use the technology in fact to target specific types of bacteria. So imagine, right, so if there's a bacteria in the gut, we actually have a lot of benign bacteria in our body. So what you want to do is to just target the bad ones and leave the benign ones alone. And using the technology that I just mentioned, it's possible to do just that.
Okay, we'll take that as an advertisement that next year we're hoping to have one of the investigators that works on how we use viruses and bacteria as therapies for cancer, but for exactly the mechanism you're thinking about.
Thank you.
So come next year. Next. Next.
My name is Maryam Volotoga, and my question is, are there any environmental factors that contribute to the deletion of the GATA6 or allele or that causes neonatal diabetes?
Okay, so what I didn't mention is, so the GATA6, the patients with the GATA6 mutations, what people have done first is they went back to sequence the parents because the first intuition is maybe it's inherited. But it's not. So the mutations are spontaneous. Now, that sort of is related to your question in that what you're wondering is whether the mutation was somehow induced by the environment. It is possible, but it's not known exactly what kind of environmental factors induce the mutation.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So why do embryonic stem cells made from somatic cell nuclear transfer, why does it age faster than regular embryonic stem cells?
Why does it age faster?
Why do they age faster?
Yeah.
I don't think it's known that they actually age faster, but I think you're talking about maybe issues with cloning. So one of the very well-known example is Dolly the sheep, and it actually did die prematurely. Now, the fact that it's just one sheep and died prematurely, it's difficult to argue whether it's an aging problem, but it is, so cloning per se may not be perfect in terms of making an organism. What's different here is we're really not talking about what's known as reproductive cloning. Instead, what we are talking about is therapeutic cloning. So meaning the use of the cloning technology to make cells that can actually be used for regenerative medicine.
So again, I'm going to limit this to one more question because we've got buses to catch and there's one more speaker to go. So one last question.
Okay. So in your research, you focus mostly on the pancreas and diabetes. Is there other uses for pluripotent stem cells that can be used, or is diabetes the only potential thing that stem cell cultures can?
I think stem cells can be used for everything. Well, of course, I'm biased, but yes, there are many, many potential usage for stem cells. And in fact, people are using it to make lung cells, to make neurons, and especially for example, a colleague of mine here uses stem cells to make dopaminergic neurons. So these are the neurons that are affected in Parkinson's disease patients. So the idea is, if you can make these neurons that are functional enough, one could potentially transplant them into those patients to potentially cure the disease.
Thank you. Great question. So we're going to go move on to our next speaker. What Danway just told us about is, by doing these explorations of how cells develop, how they maintain themselves, the mutations associated with human disease, we've come to learn a couple of really fundamental facts about cancer. First of all, the vast majority of people that get cancer don't inherit it. They don't even inherit a predisposition. This difficulty of constantly replacing the 60 trillion cells that we damage in our body as we go through life requires that cells replicate their DNA. And as she just told you, with these powerful techniques that have been harnessed from natural life, every time you do that, the cell can make a mistake in copying the DNA. That's called a somatic mutation, because it doesn't arise in something you could pass on to children, nor did you inherit it from your parents. But it gives rise to human cancer. What was asked as a question was, what then causes a higher rate of those errors as we replace cells throughout life? And we've learned about that. One you knew about when you came into this room, and the most common cause of human cancer that is avoidable is tobacco smoke, up until 2 years ago. And so for now 60 years, we have known that. It is why New York City has led the banning of tobacco in every way, shape, and form they can, rather than the complete ban, because in fact, cancer is the number one cause of cancer. And over the last decade, New York has led the decrease in smoking from what was 25% to, in your generation, something maybe under 10%. We'd like it to be zero. But unfortunately, humans like to harm their health. And so what has replaced, because cancer incidence has not gone down, what has replaced tobacco in causing errors as we replicate our DNA has been the disease obesity and type 2 diabetes that Danway just told us about. And that's why we're working so hard to get ahead of treatments of that. In America today, the number one cause of a risk of cancer is lifelong obesity and type 2 diabetes. And it's only getting worse. And it's why we really need to understand more about organismal health. 80% of cancer in America or more is caused by our environment, not because the genes you inherit from mom and dad. And that means every single cancer in us is unique to us. So if a patient gets cancer, the cancer that they get and the mutations associated with it are unique to that individual. 50% of the men in this room are going to get cancer in their lifetime. We used to say that only a third of women will get cancer in their lifetime. Unfortunately, like everything, guys, women are catching up with this, and it's now 39% of women in America in your lifetime with cancer. Now, there's some good news to that statistic. It's because Americans are living longer lives, and cancer increases, it doubles in risk with every decade you lead in life. To reach those statistics, you all have to live into your 90s, okay? But what that means is that every single tumor is different that arises. We lump them today in a hospital. We have to say you have lung cancer, or you have breast cancer, or you have colon cancer. And we lump them all together, and we're realizing that's a mistake, that each treatment, the therapies need to be personalized. And so the next speaker, David Solid, is one of our junior faculty here who has pioneered an entire new approach to both understand and to inform better and more personalized therapies about cancer. He calls it exceptional responders, and I'm going to let him tell you about it. Okay, David,
so
you're
thank
on.
Thank you. Okay, so I assume this is on. I'm going to take a little bit different approach to how I'm going to present this story. You heard from the first two speakers who are really in the laboratory trying to develop either new technology or study new biology. I'm a physician, and so coming from the side of this, of seeing patients, seeing that we don't have adequate treatments for those patients, and how can we actually go back to the laboratory to identify what's essentially wrong with each of these diseases, what's wrong in each individual patient in terms of their cancer, so we can come up with a personalized way to treat them. And so what my lab does is I try to accelerate drug discovery for patients with cancer, and it's a pretty simple approach that we take, very simple three-step approach. We try to define targets, and I'm going to explain to you what these drug targets are. They're typically things that are mutated or altered in the tumor, but not in the normal cells, as Craig mentioned. We then try to develop drugs that inhibit these targets or the pathways that are activated by these targets. And then what really has been the challenge, and what I've spent a lot of time doing, is trying to identify which of our patients have alterations in a particular gene target so that we can give them a particular drug. So how can we match up the right patient with the right drug? And so what are the targets that we talk about? Generally, targets in cancer are things that are mutated in the DNA. So patients get mutations in the DNA. Most commonly, these are somatic mutations, so they're in the tumor, not in the normal. Occasionally, they're germline mutations, things that you're born with that are predisposing you to get these diseases. And there's two ways we identify them. The first is called a genotype to phenotype approach. And this is where we take a large collection of tumors or cell lines from tumors, and we try to profile those tumors in the laboratory and figure out what's commonly mutated within that group of tumors. So we take a whole bunch of lung cancers. We analyze the lung cancers and try to find patterns that are common, and then try to identify drugs that will inhibit those mutated proteins. And that's worked well for a number of different cancer drugs and works best when there's something that's common among many different patients. And so my lab actually has tried to go ahead and take a complementary approach, and this is called phenotype to genotype. And this is where we take patients who have already responded to a drug, so we know that the drug works in at least a small subset of patients, but we typically take clinical trials or drugs where it failed in most patients but worked extraordinarily well in a small group. And we try to ask, what made those responders unique? Can we find out what the DNA changes were, what mutations made their cancer grow, made them so sensitive to these drugs? Because then maybe we can go out and find other patients who have the same mutations for which we already have a drug that works, we just didn't know who to give it to. And so the initial inspiration for this was a clinical trial we ran here at Sloan Kettering. This was a clinical trial of a drug called everolimus. This is a cancer drug that was already approved for use in patients with kidney cancer. And we tried it in patients with bladder cancer. And unfortunately, like many of the studies we do here at Sloan Kettering and just in oncology in general, this was a negative study. So what I mean by that is we enrolled 45 patients onto this clinical trial, but only 2 patients responded. And so if you look at that from a statistical perspective, well, it doesn't work in most patients. So maybe we can conclude that it doesn't work in general in bladder cancer and maybe move on to another promising idea that might turn out to be better. But what about these 2 patients who did respond? Maybe for them, this really was the right drug. And if we could figure out what made them unique, maybe we can find other patients just like them. And so what was unique about these 2 patients on this trial is that one of these 2 is a patient, I'm actually showing their CAT scans here. And really what a CAT scan is it's an imaging test that lets us look at the internal organs. And you're actually looking at the patient, actually looking at them from their feet up. And this here is the liver, these are the kidneys here, and then these parts here are the cancer. And so this is a woman who went on this clinical trial in January 2010. She very rapidly responded to this drug. So all the cancer had pretty much gone away by April. By July 2010, it was completely gone. And actually, this woman's remained on the clinical trial, July 2011, 12, 13, almost now 5 years later. She remains on this clinical trial, which was thought to be negative overall. But for her, it was the absolute right treatment. And so we asked, can we figure out genetically what makes her unique and see if there were other patients just like her? So we initially did some very targeted sequencing. That was the technology we had at the time. We could look essentially at one gene individually. And there's over 20,000 genes in the genome. And so that's a very inefficient approach. And you pretty much have to have a good idea what you're looking for going into that process. But we were fortunate in that technology is moving incredibly fast. And during the course of this study, we actually developed technology which allowed us to sequence every single gene in this patient's genome. And so what we do is we take the tumor, We take normal cells, typically from her blood. We extract DNA from the tumor. We extract DNA from the normal. And then we sequence all 3 billion base pairs of DNA within the genome, both in the tumor as well as in the normal, and ask what's mutated in the tumor versus the normal DNA from this exact individual patient. And when you do that, you get a picture like this. It's a graphical representation of all of these mutations. And it's a very complex set of mutations. This woman has over 17,000 mutations that are in her tumor that are not in her normal cells. And you say, well, how are we going to sort through all that? Well, it's a real testament to how much we've learned about the normal genome as well as tumor genomes, that we can take powerful computers, very quickly map up all 17,000 of these mutations to the genome, figure out which ones are actually in the coding regions of genes, which ones would cause a change in protein, which ones are in pathways that are actually related to this drug. And when you do that, it turns out that the patient has 2 mutations, one in a gene called TSC1, one in a gene called NF2. And the reason these are interesting is that we already knew going into this study that when you lose function of TSC1 and NF2, you activate a protein called TORC1, which is the direct target of this drug called everolimus. So in retrospect, it turned out that this woman had the perfect cancer genome mutations to make her sensitive to everolimus. We simply didn't know that fact going into the clinical trial. And so we've since gone on and actually applied this same paradigm to other patients. This is another example. This is a woman with very advanced ovarian cancer. She had failed multiple surgeries, failed multiple systemic chemotherapies, was really running out of options. And so she went on this clinical trial of a drug called AZD6244. And like the first trial, this was a disappointing study. So only a small number of patients with ovarian cancer on the trial responded. And this was actually the only woman who went on to have a complete response. But she's now over 5 years on this clinical trial with a complete response in a drug that the drug company thought was not promising enough to move forward with. So we went ahead and, again, applied this next generation sequencing technology to this woman's tumor and asked what was mutated in her tumor that could explain this. And what we found is that she actually has a deletion in one gene called MAP2K1. It deletes 15 nucleotides within the DNA, which leads to a truncated form of the protein that knocks out a negative regulatory sequence in this protein called MEK1, which turns this protein into something that's on all the time. So she's got this MEK1 protein, it's always turned on, and it turns out that the drug she was given was a direct inhibitor of this mutated protein. So again, just like the first case, it turned out that we were able to find out that she had a specific mutation in her cancer that made her sensitive to this drug. We simply didn't know that that mutation existed going into the study. I just want to point out that we always go back into the laboratory when we find these mutations and do what you heard from the last speaker, which is try to functionally validate them. So we actually create a mutated form of this protein, and we show that this pathway, this ERK pathway, which is controlled by this MEK gene, is constitutively turned on, meaning it's always turned on, and that's why the cancer cell is growing abnormally. So this is really the paradigm for this extraordinary responder initiative. We take clinical trials that were disappointing, but there were some patients who responded on those trials. We take tumor tissue from those patients. We take normal cells from those patients. We sequence them, essentially analyze their DNA to find out what made those patients unique. We always go back to the laboratory so that we can test that those hypotheses are correct, that the mutations that we're finding are actually leading to pathway activation and drug sensitivity. And then what we need is we need assays, we need tests that are going to allow us to screen all of our patients to look for these same mutations, to do a follow-up study where we treat patients with those specific mutations and see how often that's going to work. It's not guaranteed to work every time, but our hope is that most of those patients are going to respond to that treatment. So how do we go ahead and do these studies? So I'm going to shift gears a little bit and just talk in the clinic. How do we take these laboratory findings and go ahead and test them in patients? And there's really 2 ways to do those trials. One is called a genotyping study, and this is where we take a lot of patients from the same cancer, and we profile all their tumors, and then we put them on different drugs depending upon what mutations they have. So if they have a mutation in a protein called EGFR, we give them an EGFR inhibitor. If they have a mutation in a protein called BRAF, we give them a BRAF inhibitor. And if we have a mutation in this MEK1 protein I just talked about, we gave them a MEK inhibitor. And so this is a set of studies that we're setting up here at Sloan Kettering, and there's several of these type of studies that are opening nationwide to try to identify these genotype to phenotype correlations to bring these new drugs into patients even quicker. There's also another way that we do this, which is the opposite approach. So instead of designing the trial around a cancer like lung cancer or breast cancer, we actually design the trial around a specific mutation. So what we've learned is that oftentimes cancers from different parts of the body can respond similarly to the same drug if those cancers have a similar mutation. And this is the schema for one of those type of trials. It's called a basket study, where we're testing a drug called vemurafenib, which inhibits a protein called BRAF. This drug's now already approved for patients with melanoma who have BRAF mutations. And we want to know, does it work in patients with colorectal cancer with BRAF mutations, or lung cancer, or breast cancer, or a very rare disease called Erdheim-Chester? And what we do is we take all these patients, we put them into the same study, and then we try to enroll a certain number of each tumor type to see how often they respond to this drug, depending upon whether they have a particular mutation. And this is just two examples of that in a very rare cancer, where it would have been very difficult to get a trial open in this specific disease, but because we had this basket study open to any patient with any cancer who had a BRAF mutation, patients were able to enroll with this rare cancer onto that study. And this is one patient who actually had infiltration of this cancer into her brain. She was actually wheelchair-bound, unable to walk. She went on to this study. Just within a few months, all of that cancer had gone away completely, and now she's back to walking and her activities of daily living. This is another patient who actually has the cancer. It's infiltrating here, and her skin started on the drug, and you can see her cancer has completely gone away. So again, the key here is being able to figure out which patients have particular mutations in their tumor so that you can give them a particular drug. This is just another example of one of these type of studies. It's a study of a drug called neratinib, where we take patients who have mutations in a gene called HER2. Those can happen in bladder cancer, colon cancer, endometrial cancer, breast cancer. We always in these studies have an other arm, because we never know. Maybe there's other cancers who have HER2 mutations and we just don't know about them yet. But if a patient comes up with one of those tumors, we want to have a study that patient can go on. And we sometimes can see incredible results when we do this. This is a patient with breast cancer who had been through 4 prior treatments, none of which were effective, none of which were really targeting the underlying mutations that she had. We were able to identify that she had a mutation in this gene called HER2. It's a V77L mutation. It's a mutation in the part of the gene that's its enzymatic activity and turns that gene on all the time. And you can see she had all of this cancer. This is all cancer on this PET scan, all these areas, these black dots. And then within 8 weeks of starting this treatment, she's had a complete response. So again, if we can find the right mutations in these patients and give them the right drug that inhibit those mutations, we can sometimes see fairly extraordinary results. I would point out that sometimes these mutations are distributed throughout the gene. They're not always the same. So in the case of HER2, there's a cluster of these mutations located in the enzymatic area of the protein. There's also a common hotspot for these mutations within the extracellular part of the protein, and it's very possible that different mutations in this gene are going to respond different to this inhibitor, and that they're not all the same. So we actually design these trials to take patients, for example, with breast cancer, and actually give a certain number of patients with this specific mutation, for example, S310F, the drug, see how many respond, give a certain number with this mutation, L755, or another mutation, V77L, and ask, maybe it's possible that these patients respond to neratinib, but these patients are resistant. Maybe the drug doesn't bind as well when you have this mutation. Maybe tumors with this mutation are less dependent upon this specific protein. So what are the challenges to doing this? Really, the main hurdle is really identifying the patients. The problem here is that still in the United States, we only screen for any genetic mutation in about 30% of the patients with cancer. And the reason for that is that we can't prove that screening for mutations in that other 70% improves their outcome, maybe improves their survival, because we don't have a drug yet that links to a mutation in that particular disease. So how are we going to overcome that here at Sloan Kettering? Well, the way we've done that, if we've actually engineered our own assay that can, for very low cost, screen a large number of patients for hundreds of mutations in hundreds of genes at the same time. And just very quickly, how do we do this? We actually take DNA from a number of patients. We can actually ligate a barcode to each patient's DNA. And that allows us to chop up the DNA from multiple patients, mix it all together, put it into the same test tube, and then pull down the parts of the DNA from the genome that we care most about using these baits. And then these baits have biotinylated moieties on them. We can pull them down with beads. We sequence them with a very fancy machine, and then we do informatics using a computer to figure out which mutations were actually present in which patients. And this allows us to do this relatively inexpensively, so we can try to offer this type of genetic testing to every patient here at Sloan Kettering. And so our current assay has over 300 genes in this assay. These are all genes that have been shown to be mutated commonly in patients with different types of cancer, and we're about to move this assay to 410 genes going forward. And really, this is what some of the data looks like. It's really a digital readout, where each of these horizontal bars is a molecule of DNA that this machine is sequencing individually. And what we do is we take the computer, we line up those sequences, and we look for areas where there's an alteration in the DNA that doesn't match up with what we know the DNA normal sequence should look for. And this is an example where there's a mutation here in a gene called EGFR, which we know will predict for sensitivity in lung cancer to a drug called Tarceva. We can also see that there's areas of the genome where there is amplification, so too many copies of the gene or too few copies of the gene, simply by counting the number of reads we see within that gene and comparing that to the normal. And when there's more reads in the genome than would be expected, there's an amplification. When there's fewer reads, there's a deletion. We take all of this and we actually put it into a computer database. So we've got very good informatics people that can collect all of this genetic data, put it into a portal that allows our clinicians, even if they don't have great knowledge of how to analyze the raw data from these DNA sequences, to see, for example, in breast cancer, lung cancer, and prostate cancer, what mutations are we seeing in our patients. And this is allowing us to design future clinical trials against mutations for which we haven't yet developed specific drugs. And so going back to that HER2 example, it's a very rare set of mutations. So in breast cancer, it's only found in about 1% of patients. In bladder cancer, it's about 5% of patients. But we have lots of patients, and when you're sequencing every single one of those patients for these type of mutations, you find that we can find many of these same HER2 mutations and actually find enough patients to test these therapies in a very efficient way. And so this is just showing a partial list of just the HER2 mutations we found in this sequencing effort over the past few months. So as the other speakers mentioned, this is really a team science approach. I don't even have enough room on the slide to put a picture of all the people working on this, but I would just say there's a large number of people who work here on the lab side to try to do the biology and to do these development of these assays. And then there's a huge number of people on the clinical side who are seeing patients and trying to use these insights we've developed in the lab to improve the care of our patients with cancer. So thank you.
So as people get up to ask questions for David, we like to leave you also with one challenge question that's relevant to your coursework going forward. This is a math question. What David just told you about is that we have approximately 800 different drugs we can use to treat cancer. And patients can have their cancer arise because of mutations in approximately 341 genes. We don't know which drugs work best with which mutations. So how many different combinations of drug treatments do we have to test till we're sure we've exhausted all the possible combinations of drugs with individual mutations? So that's your math problem for tomorrow. Anybody that emails me with an answer will figure out how to reward you. And with that, we'll go to the first question right over there.
My name's Jason. How is everolimus created, or generally any inhibitor drugs?
Yes, so everolimus is interesting. Everolimus is actually initially derived from a drug called rapamycin, which is actually a natural product. So actually, a lot of the drugs that we use are not things that were initially synthesized in the laboratory. They were extracted from plants or yeast or bacteria, and oftentimes these natural products were generated to fend off predators. So they were toxins that could kill something trying to attack these organisms, and that's where rapamycin initially came from.
Okay, thank you.
Next, right over here.
Okay, my name is Anastasia, and I'm from International High School for Health Sciences, and I have two questions for you. What happens with tumors that don't really kill you, such as brain tumor that is too dangerous to remove? What do you do if you have it? Do they still affect you in some way?
So we have a lot of patients who have brain tumors, and unfortunately we can't cut them all out. And when that happens, if those tumors are growing fast enough, then they are life-threatening and patients do die of them. But there are some patients who have tumors that grow very slowly. There's lots of cancers that we see every day that have such a slow rate of growth that maybe sometimes it's best to just leave them in place and not treat them because the treatment could have more harm than good. And so it really is a clinical decision that sometimes the physicians have to make, you know, is this something that needs to be treated or is this something that can be watched? Probably the best example of that being prostate cancer.
Okay, and I have a second question is, I heard that there's a test that can detect if you will ever have cancer and it can help you to prevent it. How does it work?
So I don't think there is yet a test that will generally tell us that you have cancer or not. And the reason for that is that there's not one type of cancer. This is really hundreds of different diseases that have similar biology but are distinct enough. But there are tests that people are working on to try to screen for cancers much earlier so that we can pick them up in an earlier stage and cure them with things like surgery. And a big focus is actually to try to detect these mutations we're talking about in the tumor and actually in the blood. And so we know that with these cancer cells, they're sometimes dying as they're growing, the tumors are growing, and they shed some of these mutant DNA molecules into the blood. And so if we can detect that mutant DNA either in the blood or in the stool or in the urine at a very early stage, we may be able to take patients who are at very high risk for certain cancers, like women with breast cancer whose mom had breast cancer, screen those patients and maybe identify them earlier than we have in the past.
Over here.
With all the permutations of all the drugs and the mutations that could happen, how feasible is it to distribute these drugs?
Well, I think that it's very clear that doing clinical trials is very expensive, and there's nothing more expensive than doing a negative large clinical trial where you've treated hundreds or thousands of patients, and then you find out that the drug didn't really work. So really what a lot of us spend time doing is we try to use models in the laboratory to figure out what drugs might work best in a specific genetic or disease context before we take those drugs into patients so we don't make those kinds of mistakes. One of the problems we have is that our models, unfortunately, don't mimic the human disease well enough. So we still need better models, and you heard from the second speaker, efforts to try to develop these better models.
Is there a way to go in and mutate genes in order for them to react to a certain treatment?
So it's a great question. The problem is, there was a lot of hype a decade plus ago about something called gene therapy, where you could try to go and introduce genes that have been altered or lost back into the cancer cells. It hasn't worked very well for the simple reason is that by the time a cancer is visible, there's billions of cancer cells already present, and you'd have to be able to introduce that gene into every single one of those cancer cells to reverse that loss of function, which has turned out to be very difficult. So, you know, it's a good idea, but in real practice, it's been difficult to execute.
Thank you. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Maddie Ostergaard. In a clinical trial, how do you determine if a patient has had a complete response to a drug?
So it's a great question. So we do x-rays most commonly. So most of the cancers are not visible from the outside. There are some that are. So if you have a melanoma on your skin, sometimes we can just see by looking at your skin that the cancer has gone away. If we've got a tumor that's very shallow in the breast or under the arm, in a lymph node, we sometimes can just feel it. But at this point, the most common way to follow up our patients is to do very fancy types of x-rays called MRIs or CAT scans or bone scans or PET scans. And these allow us to see how big the tumor is and then whether it shrank down. Or sometimes there's functional tests like PET scans, which allow us to know whether the metabolism of the tumor has ceased. So sometimes there's a scar there, but a PET scan lets us tell the difference between that scar and an active growing tumor. And so mostly we use imaging, but we're also, again, trying to use these newer genetic tests to come up with new ways to follow the cancers. And one way to do it is we've developed technologies to actually measure the amount of these mutations in the blood. And we find when the mutation goes away and you can't detect it in the blood, typically that's associated with the cancer going away on the x-rays. And so we may be able to use these blood tests in the future to minimize the amount of x-rays we need to do. And as some of these x-rays involve radiation exposure, that could be very good for especially our young patients.
Okay, so once again, I'm going to limit this to two more questions, but all for everybody who didn't get to answer a question, all three of the speakers will be down here in front, and if you can stay, they'll come and answer your questions as long as you guys want to ask them. So last two questions, one on this side.
Okay, so my name is Marwa. And I just wanted to ask that if you find a mutation that you don't have a drug for, what's your alternate solution?
So it's a great question. It's a great question. And I would say there's three scenarios we get into when we do the genetic testing. Sometimes we find a mutation and we've got a drug for it, and that's great. Unfortunately, sometimes we find a mutation and we know there's a drug out there, but we can't get that drug for the patient. And that's because there isn't an open clinical trial. The drug's maybe not approved for use commercially. And so what we need to do is make efforts here to get access to those drugs for our patients. Sometimes we petition the drug companies to provide what we call compassionate access to the drug, or we even sometimes refer them to another hospital in the area that might have a better clinical trial than what we can offer here at Sloan Kettering. And then finally, sometimes we test the patients and we find mutations that we don't have drugs for, and there's a lot of those right now. I would say most of the mutations that we're identifying, because this type of genetic testing is very new, we haven't yet developed drugs for those mutations. And so you heard from the first speaker, he's a chemist trying to develop new drugs. We need lots of efforts here at Sloan Kettering and elsewhere to take these mutant proteins and find ways to drug them, to inhibit their activity. And that's, we got a long way to go there.
Last question.
Hi, my name is Nusrat Nasir, and I'm from the High School for Health Professions and Human Services. And my question is, can genetic alterations along with certain fighter cells in the human body potentially create a negative barrier amongst the same cells which are being used to fight terminal cancer in patients?
Say that question again. Yeah.
Can genetic alterations along with certain fighter cells in the human body potentially create a negative barrier amongst the same cells which are being used to fight terminal cancer in patients?
Can mutations or viruses create a barrier to fighting off cancer?
There's no question that there are mutations that happen in cancer cells that make you resistant to the drugs that we use. And sometimes it's as simple as there's a mutation that makes the cell pump the drug out. So as soon as the drug goes in, the cell pumps it out. And those type of mutations have been known for many years. And we're also now identifying mutations in the cells that cause resistance to the drug because the drug can no longer bind to the mutant protein. And so we're seeing all those things. And many of the labs here actually study what you're talking about, drug resistance.
Yeah. Okay, well, I want to thank everyone for coming, as I said. All three speakers are available for additional questions down front, but some of the buses, particularly out to the island, do have to leave.
Very nice.
Thank you for coming.